Hey everybody, how's everyone doing today? Hope everyone is doing great. We have an amazing guest today. Let me actually say your name, or could you tell us your name the way people should say it? Because I'll say it the way I would say it, but it's definitely wrong.
Well, in Danish, it's Pernille Ørum.
Pernille Ørum.
Yes.
I would say Pernille, because I'm such a goober. I don't know. So.
Well, let's just stick with Pernille. I think that's easier for everyone.
Yeah. So you are among a couple of artists that I found over at Instagram, and I fell in love in terms of the work you do. It is not the genre that I'm generally interested with. I'm not that much into, you know, animation kind of look and illustration kind of look, but there are certain artists that do it pretty well, and then you're one of them. So I found you.
Thank
there
you.
And it's like it's like you said before we started this call, like Instagram is such a good place to find really really cool artists and that you normally wouldn't find anywhere else. Especially, I don't know how familiar you are with the industry of, you know, entertainment design and video games and films. But in this industry, it's like not that many artists are on Instagram, and you kind of know them mostly from ArtStation.
Yeah.
But then you go into that place and like, damn, there's so many good stuff to look at. Yeah. And so I found you there, and I figured, you know what, it would be awesome to sort of figure out who you are and talk a little bit about that. I know you have some of your own projects going on, and we'll talk about that too. Would love to know more about that for sure. But maybe let's start with getting our audience more familiar with yourself. You know, I usually want to get like a good background of who am I talking with, and there's also a question that I'll ask later, just what kind of got you into becoming an artist. So, yeah, let's maybe start with, you know, where are you from and that kind of stuff.
Sure. Well, I'm from Denmark and I live in Copenhagen right now, but I grew up in a smaller town called Randers in Jutland, which is the main part of Denmark.
Mm-hmm.
And I always knew I wanted to be an animator. Actually, I thought I was going to be an actual animator and like do flipbook animation growing up with all the Disney movies and stuff, which is clearly, of course, my inspiration. If you look at the stuff that I'm doing, it doesn't come as a big surprise to anybody. So I always wanted to do that. I always wanted to be an animator and go through school. That was all I wanted. So in the eighth grade, we have something that is kind of like an internship at the job. Like you take a week out of school and you go somewhere and actually go to a workplace. And I was lucky to find out that we had a really good animation school that was about 40 minutes away from where I grew up. So I went there as an internship, and later on I got accepted and I ended up studying animation at that school, which is a really, really good school. So it's always been like a straight path down that road.
So you wanted to be in animation from like when you were a kid, or?
Yeah, I think I saw the Little Mermaid when I was around 3 or 4, and I didn't know what it was. Yeah, but I was like, whatever they did, that's what I wanted to do. I had a small period of time where I wanted to be, what's it called, like a person who work with buddies, like investigate how they died, or I don't remember what they're called, but I saw X-Files and I wanted to be like Scully for a little while, and I had a small period of time where I wanted to be like Indiana Jones, but then I got right back to animation again. So I've always known that's what I wanted, and I've always drawn. I never stopped. Like most of the people who work in the industry, it's just always been some kind of passion, because it has to be that. I think it's so much work, and it's like, to be really good, you have to maintain it all the time. So if you don't love it, you can't really do it, I think. So
yeah.
I always wanted to do that.
Yeah, art is one of those things where if you're not really passionate about it, it's really difficult to do, because unlike any other regular job, let's put it this way, which, you know, by its own mean, it's a good thing to do. It is creative. It requires from you to think a lot. Like it's not a repetitive task that you can produce every day by day without preparing for it or thinking about it. You have to like really go with an intense mind and focus on your work. It's really difficult not to focus and do things automatically.
Yeah.
I remember when I started, before I started working in this industry, I was a janitor personally. So for me, remembering that job, like I could think about millions of different things while doing it, you know, like cleaning toilets and stuff. But yeah, it's one of those jobs, like you really have to like to do it because it's going to break you.
Yeah. And also, like, for instance, what I do right now work-wise is what I love to do in my spare time. Mm-hmm. So it's really like, because it's my hobby and my job now,
right.
I'm like starting to do new stuff in my free time to feel like I'm not at work. And what I do is still drawing and painting. Now my new stuff is that I go outside and paint. And it's still a part of this whole thing. It just feels different because it's not digitally, right. Not sitting by the computer, which was my hobby before. So it's it's kind of those, like, it's just, it's what I do. It's what I love to do. And it's both in my spare time and my job. And like seeing the line is sometimes really hard. So
it's healthier, yeah. Too.
It is. It is. Yes.
Yeah, it's definitely healthier. Not sitting in front of a computer all day like I
do. Yeah, but at the same time, at my computer, I have like this, you know, I have a chair and I have this nice post. When I'm sitting in the park, I'm like this painting. So I don't know if it's that good.
The other way around.
I'm outside. So
yeah, one thing I've noticed that by just the idea of working home, and because I work from home these days mostly, but generally working in this industry, investment in the right chair is the best thing possible. Yeah, otherwise it's just like hard.
Yeah, and also like I work on a Cintiq, and I'm like, I've gotten used to it having it almost straight up, so I sit like this instead of sitting down like this.
Right.
And it took some getting used to, but it is better, I think.
Yeah, I do have my Cintiq up as well. I've seen a lot of people like looking down and having them almost like on the tabletop, but it almost reminds me of that study that been out, quite a few of them actually been out recently about, you know, use of cell phones and how it's destroying, you know, upper part of your spine.
Yeah, because she's
just like
this.
Looking down constantly.
Yeah.
So having something straight up, where your head is not down constantly, it's definitely a good idea.
Yeah, it is definitely. Now it's more the shoulder, but you can kind of like work out that instead. So.
Yeah, it's true. Definitely makes your hand. But with anything, I guess, you know, it's a passion and. You spend so much time doing it. Definitely, there's some trade off of.
It is, yeah. Health, just too many hours. Yeah.
Yeah, I've noticed that the best remedy for that is just like having walks or some kind of routine of exercise where you just do something physical and it all of the pains and
I have this. I have this every time I get a tension here. I have this workout thing I do where like you use your arms like this and it kind of loosens up everything.
Yeah,
and at the same time, in Denmark, we ride bikes a lot, which really helps for the lower back. So that helps a lot.
About,
but getting out of moving is definitely the trick.
There's a lot of bikes there. I was talking to you before we started the stream. I have a friend, Jesper Andersen. He lives in Denmark. We used to work together at Crytek, and he was telling me about that all the time. You guys don't drive cars.
I don't even know how to. I can't drive a car, actually.
In Copenhagen, I don't think you need to have a car. It's just such a
well-connected
city.
Yeah, but I do go to LA once in a while now, and it's getting more and more difficult. I know Uber is there, but at the same time, nice to be able to
drive. Can be around with Uber. That's fine.
Yeah.
You don't have... Honestly, go Uber. Like, if you ever move to
LA. I want to go outside of LA, like I would like to go into the desert and stuff.
Oh,
I need somebody to.
Yeah, that's true.
Me.
That is for that. Yeah. You kind of want to have. Yeah, I agree with that. Like, there's so much nice stuff around LA, just not in LA. I mean, LA is great. Don't get me wrong. It's just too crowded.
Yeah. It is. Yeah, it is definitely.
It is one of
So.
those. Yeah, that's why I don't drive to work anymore, because it's just I did that 2 years ago, where I would be going to like the film studios in Burbank. It's
Yeah.
like 45-minute to an hour drive one
It
way.
is insane.
Yeah, and that meant to me like the quick calculation towards the end of the project, like, I'm spending about 40 hours in the traffic every month. That's a
That's
full
ins
work week.
yeah. That is insane.
Let's not do that.
No, definitely let's not do that.
Yeah, Copenhagen is I have never been in Copenhagen, but I've heard only nice things about it.
It
You
is
guys
very
have,
nice.
yeah, it's pretty nice city. Denmark is pretty nice too, I think.
Yeah, it's nice and cozy country. It's a cozy country.
Yeah, it's pretty small. It's pretty nice, pretty cozy. People are nice there. It's all good. It's all good. So you primarily got interested with this route by just, I guess watching animations and seeing like Disney films and finding your
Yeah, that
inspiration there.
and comic books. Yeah.
Got it.
I was a huge comic book fan, especially Marvel, the 90s Marvel. So I was really into that along with the with the Disney. So most of my youth, I spent, drawing after both the animation books and comic books. And then after school, I went to the school that I mentioned to, the animation workshop in Denmark, it has different lines, but I took the traditional animation line, which is where you have 1 year where you draw on paper, 1 year where you do 3D, and 1 year when you do film.
Got it.
I left that school. Thought I was going to be an animator, 3D animation, because that's kind of what you have, like
Because
what you
why
have to
not?
do now. Yeah, and actually before that, I actually did an internship at Cartoon Saloon, which was amazing. I don't know if you know that studio. It's in
No, not
Ireland. They
really.
did Brendan and the Secret of Kells and Song of the Sea, which is 2D animation movies. It's very flat design. It's very beautiful animation. But they were between those two projects. So while I was there, wasn't really anything for me to do. So I moved on and I went to London where I worked on John Carter, the feature film John Carter as
Oh,
a
okay.
3D animator. Yeah.
That's the o
It's,
that's the
it's, it
only
was kind
project
of a
that rings
deep.
the bell
Yes. Yes, I thought it might. It was the Disney flop
Yeah, it
where I
was,
worked on
apparently.
it was yeah where I worked on the aliens. I did the animation for some of the background aliens, and I just remember sitting there working million hours a week and not drawing anything, and sitting next to people who didn't know how to draw, and I kind of knew that that wasn't for me,
Right.
so I resigned that, moved back to Denmark, and started to figure out what I wanted to do instead. And then I got on the route that I'm on now, where I started doing backgrounds first, and I started showing my character work on online, and things kind of took off from there. So
So you
that's like
kind
a quick overview of my.
right, you kind of dabbled in a few areas and then figured out like, nah, I kind of want to do this after all.
Yeah. It's because I always thought I was going to be an animator. I love moving characters and I love being able to understand a character all the way around. But I didn't like doing the 3D animation. It kind of lost what I really liked, drawing and stuff. So it felt like I didn't explore that skill that I had developed, and
Right.
I didn't, it felt like any other job. It was a cool job, a really, really cool job, but not really what I wanted to do. So that's why I started, I never thought I was going to do visual development and character design, but I always thought, that's the best of the best who gets to do that. But
Yeah, yeah.
I've been fortunate enough to get really, really cool assignments and growing with the assignments and getting better, and it's like I wouldn't trade it. except for if they did, you know, really, really cool. I would love to get back into animation once, but, you know, it's a skill you have to be really, really, really good at. And there's no
it's
project,
extremely
difficult.
You know, yeah.
It is so difficult, and you don't have anything to aspire to. There are some cool projects, but I think I'm falling more and more in love with visual development.
Yeah. Yeah. It's,
so
it's
now
different...
just enjoy it, have the skill.
That's true. It is a different craft. And sad thing about it is, like, you fell in love in animation that you saw, like, back in the 80s and 90s, which was even 70s at that point, which was more traditionally drawn, like, traditionally made. And that's completely different to what it is now. Like, there's absolutely no films that are done traditionally anymore. Andrew, what was that? Who was working on that, the paper film? I think we know someone from there. The paper.
Was this the Klaus? Is there making the movie Klaus? But I don't know if it's on paper or if it's on.
No.
I think it might be.
It was this like black and white short animation. I think it was done by Disney or Pixar. I can't remember. That's how bad I am with animation.
there you go.
But there was this black and white Disney-esque. And it was like about a guy and the girl, and it was like
Paperman.
Paperman. Yeah, there you go.
Yeah. Okay. Gotcha.
God damn it.
I thought that was done in 3D with some kind of shading that made it look
2D.
Yeah.
Yeah. So they made it look like it's a 2D animation, but it was 3D as well. I had this discussion with a couple of friends about anime as well, like the anime. The way it works today, it's completely different than it used to be back then. When you watch anime films from the 80s or 90s, my favorite ones, Akira and Ghost in the Shell, they've been done all traditionally, like, you know, drawn on paper, broken down into, you know, different kind of lines and shading, and then eventually, you know, clean up and scans and all of that stuff and cell shading. All of that produced by hand. You look at the anime done today, it's all 3D. Really, it's all 3D. There's no like 2D character anymore. I also like dabbled into software that they use for scanning and, you know, then animating the frames. And it's just like, wow, it's all frame by frame. There's no like ease ins and ease outs. Like there's none of those animation tools. It gets you like to appreciate the animation craft on its own. And makes you to understand like how difficult it is, because it's one thing like those guys had to be amazing at drawing to start with, but then also have like this sensibility for moving things and timing.
Oh yeah, and overlap and all the different joints, and it's not just like then the overlaps of the different like follow through and
right
all that math that actually kind of goes into it.
Yeah, it's all by hand. All by hand.
Yeah,
frame
it's
by
insane.
Frame.
Yeah. Also one of the things that I think that's really a pity, like for instance, if you look at like Lady and the Tramp or the Jungle Book or the really old Disney's, those are amazingly beautiful still.
Yeah.
And I'm not sure that the ones that are being made now, even though they are beautiful, a lot of them, I don't think they're going to hold up as well, because you can see most of the 3D animated films. They don't hold up visually. Like the story might hold up or the character designs and the ideas, but the look just keeps developing and the skill set within that media. So
yeah, why do you think it is that way? Why do you think 3D animation don't hold up, apart from, you know, I guess just feeling dated with the technology, right?
I don't know, it just doesn't have that The other thing feels like a good craftsmanship. Like it's
right.
It's I don't know. It's different kind of love. That's why I love the art books for the new films, because you can definitely tell, like with the large productions, like for instance Frozen, beautiful artwork that's done with Frozen, like the art book and the paintings that's done and the development and. Everything there is amazingly done, and the movie is beautiful. But I just think that it's going to lose more and more of the beauty in it, because there's something, I don't know. It's just doesn't feel right, if it makes sense. I don't know if right. it's texture. I'm not technical, so I don't know what it is, but it just doesn't have that that appeal. I love the artwork way more than I love the actual finished films. And I think, for instance, Moana right now is a beautiful movie. It's absolutely beautiful, but also know that in a few years I'm going to look at it and be like, ah, this might not be.
Yeah,
because we keep developing it. It's
Yeah, I remember seeing Wall-E, and Wall-E was like, man, that movie looks amazing. And now looking back at it, like, oh, I can see all the textures.
Yeah, it doesn't hold up. And it's really tough watching Toy Story, for instance, the first one. It's really tough to watch it, I think, visually. But I love listening to the audio because the story is amazing. And so it's
one of my favorites, the first one and the third one. The third one is pretty good. I think the first one was the best. Yeah.
I cried at the third one.
Oh, I don't think I cried at the many of the films. I did cry like pretty much any other kid during Lion King.
Oh, yeah.
I think every kid
cried. If you didn't, you would be, that's
heartless.
A tough one.
Heartless.
Yeah, it would be heartless, yeah.
Do you know Aaron Blaise, by the way? Do you know, have you ever seen his work? He was actually an animator over at Disney for The Lion King. He was also directing Brother Bear.
I know. Oh, yeah, I know who he is. I love his work. I'm really bad with names. He's the one who does these amazing paintings of bears, right?
Yeah, and animals.
Yes.
He's such a nice guy.
Oh, I just drew this today, and it's just amazing big piece of just the realistic bear or something.
Yeah, I worked with him on the project over at Digital Domain, and out of the whole Digital Domain experience, that was the only positive experience, because everything else about Digital Domain sucked. he's such a nice guy. He's like a papa bear. Like he's like this, your grandfather that's always happy and positive and like really nice and.
I could imagine.
Yeah, because I only ask because he is one of those people that are really, really deep and deep into the traditional way of doing animations. And we worked together on this film that got canceled. It was Legend of Tembo, I believe. And everything.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, and he was like creating animation frames and ideas all on paper. I remember seeing those, like, wow, like this is so cool. This is gonna be such a different experience when you're gonna see the film. But yeah, it collapsed.
Well, that's also, for instance, the animation in Tangled is really, really good because Glenn Keane went in over and drew over all the frames,
right?
Like to make the animators push the characters. Like you can really tell that it was like pushed more because you know drawing over it, he kind of. You know, pushes and stretches and stuff. He really, really did some amazing work supervising the animation in that film.
Yeah,
you can definitely tell.
I think it has to deal with the imperfection and organic way of how when you work traditionally, how you create lines and how you create movements and all of that. Whereas in computers, there's a lot of things you can do as a shortcut. In the computer and software world where, you know, you build something in 3D and you light it perfectly and then you have those ease ins and outs and you have like those animation flows that you can use and those scripts that make everything super fast and you can edit everything on the fly. But as you're doing it, I think you're oftentimes those films are starting to lose that imperfection that you're going to have by not being computer perfect at framing everything frame by frame, you know, that kind of stuff. And I think that's for animation. When it comes to art, I was always wondering why when you look at artists' work and you see traditionally drawn work, why it's capturing much more attention when you have a really good traditional art versus when you have like a really, really good digital art. And I think it's that novelty or that the quality that comes from the craftsmanship, like you said, that you know it takes a certain amount of skills and there's no shortcuts when it comes to traditional art that you can make because you have to have everything in place in order to make something that is really, really great, Whereas in computers, like, oh, I'm gonna control Z the hell out of it, you know?
Yeah.
Basically, so yeah, it's crazy. It's there's something about it, definitely. And I'm looking at it personally, and I'm sort of missing like those days where, yeah, it's like I wish traditional art was more accepted in the industry. I think to a degree it is, especially when it comes to like it's called internet celebrities.
I also think like a lot of the studios, larger studios, make time and room for the artists to experiment with. For instance, Pixar, Disney, I know they make room for the visual developers sometimes to work with paper or with paints and stuff like that, because it does give a different expression if you're limited and you have to, you know, okay, I only have this material. How do I express what I want to express, and how do I capture this character like as easy as possible? Because when you do digital, you do have a tendency to go into details really quick, because if it's not right, you can always go out and resize and you know, yeah, work under that layer. Where on the other hand, if you do something traditionally, you have to know what you want to do from the get-go, because you can't go back. If you start one place, you can't go back.
Yeah, it's very difficult to fix things once they're done.
I think you can tell the people's artwork who work digitally if they used to work traditionally, because there is like something about their digital work I like that has like a simple, I don't know if it's simpleness or just a different feel.
Right.
You can see that people are used to working traditionally as well, and not only digitally, that I like as well.
Yeah, I think it's because if you work traditionally, yeah, you don't have control Z as you're drawing with inks. Like once you place the line, it's there. So you have to be really economic about how you place your lines and really deliberate. Is that the correct line I should be placing here?
Yeah.
Is it gonna
Or if you're like inking with black at the end of the drawing, you're really, you know, this is the moment.
I think it's the most stressful when it comes to art. It's like knowing there's no way back. I cannot imagine like those comic artists.
I always put the, you know, oh, me either.
Yeah.
I'm so impressed by them. I just, you know, having to draw like lashes, that's always one of the last things that I do. And I know if I'm not doing it right, it just ruins everything. It's one of those, you know, okay.
You should probably start with it then. Like just have a, just have like,
but it's always
copies
on top of everything. And it's the darkest. So.
Yeah.
Yeah.
No, yeah. It's like you spend like, let's say 5-6 hours, or half a day on that one drawing, and you're about to get that last line and your hand slips. Like, oh my
God. Oh no. You put too much water in. Yeah. Gone.
Yeah. Yeah, I think that's what it is. I think that's what makes it special, because you know you cannot make mistakes, and if you see something that is really, really amazing looking, if you see that artwork that you're really impressed, like, oh my God, this is looking awesome, you know that it took a lot of effort and there were no mistakes made. Whereas you can see a drawing in you know, in Photoshop or Painter or whatever, and you don't know. You know, could have taken a half an hour, could have taken 2 days, could have been started from scratch many times, or just overpainted the hell out of it. So you never know. There's so many ways to mask things and test things with layers, and
it is. Yeah. Putting in different images and
exactly.
Yeah.
That's true. So do you plan to go back to animation at some point or any point, or try it?
I think I'm just gonna might dabble with it a bit, just for myself, but I don't think I'm going to go back as an animator, because I am really falling in love with the visual development part of it.
Got it.
But I do miss, I am a freelancer now, and I live in Copenhagen, and a lot of the projects that I'm working on are in LA, which means that I do miss sometimes being a part of the production with the production, like the whole team, sitting with the animators and sitting with the post-production and pre-production and and that part of it I sometimes miss, but I think happy where I am right now, where it's visual development mostly.
So you're working with like Disney right now, or can you say anything about that, or
I cannot say anything about working with Disney right now, but I am working with DC and Golden Books right now, where I'm working on a second book for DC Superhero Girls, which I helped develop that show. And now I'm making some books for them, which is a lot of fun. It's really nice because the TV show was very high tempo, and making books is way more, you know, we just need something in 3 weeks, you know, have fun. It's like, oh, okay. So
I dig that. I dig that.
It's very nice tempo. So that's definitely not the last time I'm doing that. It's I love doing that. Yeah.
Yeah. Film and TV are relentless when it comes to it is. Creating art. And that's really difficult. You have to produce on your highest, and you don't have time to slack, really. It's really sort of like tied in, all the screws are in place, and you cannot, you know, fuck around, if I can say that. I've never worked in books or you know, in sort of like typical illustration environment. So for me, it's like very alien world. I did some book covers for producers and friends that I know, or some of the, I think I did one book cover, but it was like way, way back when I was starting. It was one of those like gigs like I had to do. But yeah, I'm curious how this industry works, you know, compared to film. What do you think? Like, if you could compare both, because I'm pretty sure there's a lot of artists out there that are, you know, thinking like, oh, I should maybe go film because film is like prestigious and all of that stuff. But then,
well, film is hard, and it's they always needed yesterday, and
that's true.
They always needed to be brilliant from the get go, but they don't really know what they want. But I must say, I really, really love doing books, but I also know that I have to go back to do animation soon because that is where my heart is.
Right.
But I do love having a book on the side wouldn't be a bad thing for me, you know, always having a book or two to do within a year. Because it is really, really nice. The timeline is better. You like work with the whole project. You do the sketches, you do the storyboarding, you do the artwork, and you do the final, and you end up sitting with a final product, which is really nice because at animation, you do something, you send it out, and you don't really see it again, and it might end up in the film.
Yeah, that's true.
So there is some kind of payoff with books that I really like, but my heart is really with the animation, so it's, yeah.
It's coming back there.
It is coming back. Well, it's like visual development, but, you know, working in the animation.
Yeah.
Because for instance, when I worked at DC, or Warner Brothers, I worked for Warner Brothers with the DC Superhero Girls.
Mm-hmm.
I did all the character designs for, I think, like 90% of the characters. And there are, I don't know, over 100 incidentals and new villain in each show. And it's fortunately done most of it in my style, but I did hundreds of character designs in 2 years. And, you know,
and also, right?
it is, yeah, you know, we need 5 characters by the day after tomorrow. It's like, okay, and it's just, you know, it needs to be like, it's just, and it keeps going. It's nonstop. It keeps, and keep wanting to have characters and new things and stuff. So it is really, really hard work, but it was also fun. Like, you're part of a team and you lift the assignment together, but it's definitely different than doing books.
Yeah, you touched upon something really interesting here, and I think it's worth mentioning. When you work in film or animation, for that matter, like, everything is for yesterday, and there's certain requirements that they have from you in terms of like how much you're going to produce and what the results are going to be at the end of the day, and it can be really stressful. And the biggest issue I have with that is like, you really don't have that much time to develop the idea properly. It's like you're almost always going to be about 60-70% there where you want it to be, and then you sort of like have to move on. There are rare instances where you work on something very specific. Like, I'm working on this project right now, or I'm only doing one thing. I'm doing hundreds of iterations. Again, like it's one of those things where you would kind of wish you want to like create an idea and work on it, and sort of like dabble it and do changes, but still be within the same realm. But oftentimes it just happens that, depends on who you work with, but oftentimes you work with a person that just really don't know what they want. And they want to see ideas because they want to explore different places up until the moment that they find that the right thing. Whereas when you work on a book or maybe personal projects too, you have that time, the luxury of time to actually develop idea a little further and, you know, go through the whole process, the proper process of, you know, finding what the character is, what are the traits and how you develop it, what parts of the character is going to make it feel stronger, what kind of color choices you can make. You don't have that luxury in film. It's like, you're done? No? Why?
Yeah.
You know, so it can be really, really stressful and difficult. I agree with that.
Yeah.
I guess it's a trade-off. Like, if you want to be in that realm of visual development, you know, that's the trade-off of being there.
Yeah, it definitely is. I've also been lucky to have a few assignments. Those are really like, it's where some company is contacting me and they're like, we're doing a new TV show and we think your style would be good for the TV show. So would you mind doing your take on these characters? And then they need it by, like, you have a week to do it or so. And you just dabble and, you know, start to figure out like who are these characters are and how you would like them to. I'm really fortunate to get a lot of those where they need something for pitches. And the hard thing about it is that you, most of the time you don't end up, like it doesn't end up becoming anything because, you know, a lot of pitches out there. And if it get chosen, it's not likely that they'll choose you again. They might just, you know, go with people that they have in-house and stuff, but just use what you did. But for assignments to do, I really, really love doing those. It's a fun task. It's like a week of intense, I'm doing this right now or stuff like that. So
yeah, there's something.
Luckily I'm getting some of those.
There's something the point you made about, you know, when you work on books, you kind of at the end of the day, you are in front of your product, the stuff that you worked on for a while and you've been through the whole process from inception to finish and now you see it, it's there. It's presented. It's a vital part of the project. In animation, it's you work on those hundreds of different sketches. It might so happen that one of them gonna end up almost frame by, like, you know, one by one in the frame of a film, but in completely different look. Not what you've created. Yeah, it's crazy. Yeah. It's one of those things that I don't know if it kills artists in terms of creativity, because like, you work on those ideas, you don't really have time to develop them, and majority of them get discarded anyways.
Yeah.
Feel very
wasteful.
Well,
that's why you need to have your own project on the side.
Right.
Like, you can't put your heart into everything you do at work, because then you'll die slowly. I think.
Yeah.
You have to have your own things.
Yeah, you kind of want to do your own things, for sure.
Yeah.
I've noticed that, because I personally was really invested into work and forgetting my personal work. I used to do sketches here and there, but up until the moment where I started like developing my own project on my own pace, where I can just think about the characters and do stuff that I really want to do, it was like, you slowly kind of like get discouraged, you know, like,
you lose your passion for the industry, I think, if you don't maintain your own stuff. That's definitely also what I have had that happen to me, and I'm really happy that I'm doing everything at the same time now, because there's like, it revamped the whole passion for the industry.
So you have your personal project. I want to talk about it in a moment, but I have one more question. So you said you went to, a university. It's in Denmark.
It's a bachelor degree. Yeah.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
How do you think, because, you know, for entertainment industry specifically, when you think about working in film, there's not that many schools out there that will teach, especially like traditionally driven schools, that will prepare you for what's about to come when it comes to video games industry and in the film industry specifically.
Yeah.
I'm guessing it's different for illustration. I wonder how much of the school that you went to helped you versus how much you've actually learned by yourself, like just, you know, being self-taught.
Well, I would say the school meant helped me a lot.
Okay.
The school is made in this really great way, where there's no teachers there. It's like there are no teachers who work there. All the teachers are people in the industry who come in for a week or two, and then just teach. Like one person comes in. We had a guy who taught us rigging, for instance, which was ridiculous because we were animators, but we just needed to understand rigging. But the guy who came in and taught us rigging had rigged Woody from the Toy Story 3. So like it's really, really, really good people who are in the industry right now. They know what you need to know, and they also, you know, it's a connection that you have. So when you come out, they know who you are.
Right.
So the school is really, really well equipped to get people ready for the industry, and they do a lot of, you know, teamwork from the get-go, so people know how it is to work together. And a lot of it, you know, you have a week to do this assignment, which is like good time frames for when you go out into the industry as well. So actually, right, this school has prepared really well, but I do know a lot of people who have gone to schools where it's something that you need. Yeah, and you needed it like 10 years ago because everything keeps changing so much. That's why it's so good that they get teachers who are actually in the industry.
Yeah.
So
I think that's the biggest issue with the traditional brick and mortar kind of schools where by the way, what was the name of the school that you went to?
The animation workshop.
Okay. It's in Denmark, right? In Copenhagen?
Yeah, it's Viborg, Viborg actually.
Oh, Viborg. Okay.
It's very rural, which is amazing because it's this little campus and everybody there is just into animation. So you just live in your own little world for 3 years and it's
That's cool.
everything for you. And all the teachers who come there just love it so much because it's just this little intense world.
How much do you think connections you made in that school helped you to in professional work?
Well, if I continued where at the path that I was going, mm-hmm. It would have helped me a lot. What I've done now, I stepped back, but no, I would still say that it has given me a lot. Not what I'm working for now, but I have this whole network of people, and it's
right.
I think 30 or 40% of them are from the school. I have in some way been connected to the school, and
yeah.
It is a lot. It just I keep forgetting where I know people from. So no, the school is absolutely amazing when it comes to that. But I also know that it's unique, like the way it's set up.
It sounds very unique. Just the fact.
And it has a line now, actually, that. Yeah, it has a line now that does the work that you're kind of doing, which is more, it's a CG line where they do visual effects for films and for games. And a lot of it is more naturalistic styles, and they learn matte paintings and stuff as well. So it is a really, really good, good school.
I know there are VFX schools that are really good in London. And when it comes to US, there's a couple of, I think there's maybe two or three. The one obviously the most people are familiar with is Art Center in Pasadena.
Yeah.
That's like the biggest one, and that has the most that's traditionally been great, and has, you know, they always have top of the line teachers, and like very much like that animation school, it is the place where they would hire people from the industry to teach.
Yeah,
they'll have their faculty that. But the faculty themselves work in film. I interviewed on Art Cafe Tim Flattery, who was one of the heads of entertainment design actually in that school. And yeah, he's a guy who works in film constantly, and he was doing that while working there. He's not there anymore, but I think that connection you have when you work with people that are in the industry, especially if you want to learn, that's the only reason why I would go to a school like that, where you actually have people that know what they're talking about. I mean, the biggest disconnect is when you have universities and schools that have some people that work there for like 30 years and have no, absolutely zero connections to what's going
on
in the industry.
It doesn't give you anything.
Yeah,
it just sounds really expensive.
It's just draining money and nothing else. That's true. Yeah. That sounds awesome. Yeah, I never knew about that school. It's something I'm gonna.
No, you should
Google
look it up.
Yeah, I'm gonna look it
and
up.
And it's also really weird because, like, again, grew up Jutland in Denmark, and it was 40 minutes away, and I always knew I wanted to do it, and it's one of the best schools in Europe for animation.
Like
it. So it was just one of those, like, okay, I guess it's meant to be.
Yeah, that's true. So let's talk about your project. You have a Kickstarter.
Yes, I do.
You get funded in what, 40 minutes?
In 43 minutes. It was extremely, it was very overwhelming. It was one of those where like, oh, I knew it was probably going to go okay quick because I got a good response when I said I was going to do it. But I had a friend coming over to, you know, look at it and see how it was going to go the first day. And she came an hour after I launched and I was like, sorry, it's already done. But thank you for coming.
So what is this Kickstarter about? Tell us what it is.
It's a book called Coral, and it's a follow-up book to another Kickstarter I did about 2 years ago. It's just a collection of artwork. It's okay. There's nothing written in it or anything. It's just a book filled with images of stuff that I've done in
just
my free
book
time.
Full of awesomeness.
Just book full of awesomeness, yeah. So
that's awesome. I'm glad it worked out. I mean, it looks like, 40 minutes, that's a hell of a deal, and it worked out. That's awesome. That's something that I really admire about the state of the industry today. I mean, it is more and more difficult to get job in the industry, right? Like, if you want to be an animator, it's so much more competitive than it used to be a couple of years ago even. But like places like Instagram, Facebook, Twitter, all of the social media are just opening doors for artists to be themselves, and even Kickstarter as well, right? Because with Kickstarter, you're just expressing yourself. It's just like true you.
There's just me. Completely me, yes.
Yeah,
so,
there's
no art director
on top of your head like saying, okay, can you I like
this
drawing
great,
but
I don't like the it also because like some people are like, oh, I'm not a big fan of the font. It's like, too bad, it's my book.
I know you wanted this character to be a girl, but can you make it a boy? Can you show it from the side, and would it be hard to do? Like,
it looks really
from scratch.
Oh man, giving me flashbacks. Yeah.
That's how the industry works.
It is, yeah. I know. I love this. Just having complete say in everything that I'm doing with it. I really like and also gathering my thoughts. Also, a really cool thing. I actually haven't announced it yet, but I can mention. The movie director Kevin Smith.
Mm-hmm.
Do you know he is doing the forewords in my book.
Oh, snap.
Yeah.
That's
awesome. Pretty cool.
Congrats.
Yeah, thank you.
That's
great. I've met him. I met him last time I was in LA. We were working on something together. So he's been really nice about wanting to write in my book. So it's just one of those, I can, gather what I want in it because, my artwork is really girly and stuff. And then you have Kevin Smith, who's something else, but I just think he fits perfectly in the book that I want to do. So
awesome.
It's just really cool to be able to gather stuff and, share it with people, and that there's actually people who want it as well is really, really nice.
Yeah. It's much more exciting, I would say, than any other, like looking at what people do with personal projects. For me personally, it's so much more exciting than looking at the new film that is coming out. I'm sort of starting to get jaded about the industry in general.
Yeah, me too.
Don't get
me
wrong.
Just, there's
so
much,
love,
and it's just noise. And yeah,
I love working with people though. Like again, like you've mentioned this, working from home is so different, and you kind of miss that jazz of being in the fray of other artists and whatnot. But even then, like when you work with like really cool production designers or art directors, there's something about that connection you make that is more important than what projects you're on.
Yeah. For sure.
I've noticed that. How do you actually? I have a question because that's bothering me personally, and I started to get curious how other artists deal with that. So, what I've noticed when I work on any specific project, and I don't know if it's just me or if that applies to everyone, but like after 3 weeks of being super excited, I was like completely drained. Like I don't want to fucking work on that stuff anymore.
Yeah.
Do you go through like phases like that where you on the project and then you get completely like, man, like I know I have this deadline that I need to produce for and I hate it. So I think the best choice would be to work on my personal project now.
Definitely. I have that too. And also like I have it where I wake up in the morning and I'm like, okay, today's the day. This is going to be amazing. And you sit down at the computer and you just feel the energy just like drain out of you because you just sat with that project for so long. Right. I agree. And it goes up and down.
So how do you deal with those moments? Because there are phases of the things that are...
Well, if there is enough time, which there seldomly isn't, I like to just put it on the side and maybe do some of my own stuff, like doodles and stuff, which, you know, gets me going.
Yeah.
Or otherwise, it's just one of those, routinely enough, you know, put on an audiobook or some podcast and just go through it.
Yeah, podcasts help.
Definitely. Everybody has jobs. Oh, podcast helps a lot. Everybody has the job days where, you know, you just like every other job.
Yeah, I just want to dispel that myth.
Work sometimes.
I just want to dispel that myth that everything is great and those projects are amazing. The more you work in this industry, you kind of realize that everything is kind of the same and nothing is special. Even the most special project that you worked on, the way you've done it before so many times, there's nothing really that interesting about it.
Absolutely. I've never had a job that lasted more than 3 days where I haven't had one of those days where you're just like, ugh, you know, just, it's just, there's something about when you do something and it's not your own, even if it is your interpretation of something, it's somebody else's project. And it can be really cool and you can be really lucky to work on it. And you can think that what you're doing for the project is amazing, but it's still not your project. So it's still, you know, you still have those days where you don't want to be doing that exact thing, I think.
Yeah, there's something about like, I find these moments where you work on someone else's project, obviously, but you find that niche that you feel like you own it and you can do something about it, right? And if you're allowed to do it, that's great. And that kind of keeps your interest going. But oftentimes you're just like, you create like your best idea. Like, damn, like I made it. Like, this is it. This is exactly what this is supposed to be. And then you get a comment like, I don't know. Like, let's change it. I don't like
that. That's actually when you think you have the project and they come in and come with notes and you're like, but that's not better. It's like, it's actually draining when you start, they keep like pulling stuff up for every time you deliver. You're just like, it's nice, but could you just change? And in the end, I actually sometimes end up just fixing the things and not being critical about it. I just do the changes that they want. And then you'd end up not liking what it is. And they don't like it because they didn't really know what they were asking for. And so it just ends up being this weird thing sometimes. If you know, if it's too much, you just kind of give up and you're just like, okay, I'll do it. You know, I'll move it over here. It doesn't make sense, but I'll move it over here. Or it can be red if you want.
Yeah. I mean, this industry, man, it's just that. Yeah.
It is.
That's why, I mean, personal projects is definitely the way to go. I have my own and I'm kind of like cooking it slowly. I'm trying to get away from the pressure. I think the worst thing you can do when you work on your personal stuff is make it feel like it's work. Because then it'll just like kill it. That just kills it for you. I think it's fine to struggle every now and then. You know, like if you, even on the personal stuff, like you're just kind of trying to push through. Because I think struggle, like when you're struggling and you are having those difficulties with something, that's when at the end of the day, when you succeed and make it happen, you feel so much nicer. You actually enjoy the spoils of that small victory a little more than if everything goes great all the time. But the moment is like you get someone expect you something and that's the moment where it's like just kills it. It feels like every day now. Like, I don't want to do that.
Yeah. Yeah, for sure. And nobody's paying you for it too. It's like, yay.
Yeah. That's the thing. Like, I'm working for free and people have expectations. Yeah. I don't want to do it. Yeah. So that's for Kickstarter. It kind of does that. I feel like it could do it to me if I would start a Kickstarter for myself. Cause I have my project that I've been asked to do Kickstarter for it many times, but I feel like if I do it, it then becomes work for me. I don't know. Was that for you when you decided to do it?
Well, I make sure that I have everything done before I launch the Kickstarter. Right. Like, I haven't put the whole book together, but I've gathered all the artwork I want to put in it. And I've kind of, you know, set up as much as I could. It does end up becoming like a bit of work, you know, navigating a Kickstarter is hard. And also, you know, you end up adding more stuff than you thought you weren't going to do. So, for instance, I've just put on that I want to do like tutorial pages in my book if I make it to a certain level. Mm-hmm. Like if I reach one, and I haven't made those, so those would definitely be one of the things that I would have to do extra.
Right.
But I would never set up a Kickstarter and then after that do the work, because then I would have this enormous pressure all of a sudden to get it done. Yeah. Because working on it could be fun. Yeah.
Yeah, you kind of want to have everything done and let the Kickstarter to help you actually produce it produce the final steps where the creative part is already done. So you're not getting pressured. You're not getting upset and like frustrated that you are forced to deliver something and you're not because, you know, whatever.
Also if you're sure that you like it, I couldn't imagine, you know, doing, say, I'm going to do this comic book, for instance. And then you see halfway through this comic book, it's going to be really, really bad. But 1,000 people already bought it, so now you have to do it. So, but it's also a privilege to be able to afford it time-wise to do it. But this one has been 2 years in the making. It's like artwork from the last 2 years. The other one was also for 2 years prior. So it is. I do get around it easily by having it be, you know, gathering of artwork I've already done.
Right.
Most of it I've already put up online, but
yeah, it is cool. I mean, there's something different about having it in a book though, than in pictures. Definitely. That's for sure.
And that's why I made the first Kickstarter. That's actually because I wanted to own a copy of my book. It just said Pernille on it. That was actually why I made the Kickstarter. And it went really well and I was so surprised. So
that's awesome.
So I wanted to try it again.
Well, good luck with that one. I mean, it's already funded. It's already going there. So it's going to happen, I guess. But it's just you still have a little bit of work to do in front of you. So for sure.
Yeah.
I'm pretty sure we're going to have a couple of questions. I wanted to ask you one more thing. Oh, okay. I remember now. So as I said in the beginning, I found you on Instagram, right? And you on Instagram, there's not that many artists that have that large audience, honestly. You how many people are following you?
I think it's 365,000 people. Yeah, it's insane. It is.
How does it feel to you? I mean, when you started Instagram, I guess like pretty much any other artist, you started with a premise of like, oh, it's gonna be just another place for me to share my work.
Yeah, it was actually, I saw, I had a Blogspot, you know, one of those. And I remember seeing some artists that had a Instagram, and she did some work that I really liked. And I was like, I think I could do that too. I think she had like 1,000 followers. And I was like,
right.
That looks pretty cool. And I remember, you know, reaching up to her at some point, you know, because I was like, I want to be as good as she is. So I made her, and then, you know, started seeing that there was more of a world, and I just keep finding artists that I was inspired by and mm-hmm. who I wanted to be, you know, oh, this guy does this. This looks really cool. I want to do more of this. And, you know, keep developing your work by seeing more and more people on Instagram. So I actually developed a lot of my style while I was on Instagram, because there was just, as you said, there's so many people there, like
it's
so many artists, and
it's
it is, and it's their personal work, and it's it's a lot of it is so freely because it's you know, it's half hour doodles and it's, I just had a lunch break, so I did this, and yeah. It's not a lot of finished pieces, and that's what I really like about Instagram, is that it's very intuitive. It's very, you know, passionate art, I think.
Yeah, it's pretty so, large. There is a pretty large volume of amazing art, I would say, on Instagram.
There is, yeah.
Out of any
and,
places.
You know, it is. And, you know, I don't know what happened, man. It just, all of a sudden, it just exploded with my Instagram. I was part of a thing called Sketch Dailies. And I think that's one of the things that pushed me in the beginning, which was this guy also from LA who started with every day he posted a new subject, and then everybody just drew that thing. And, you know, apparently I was one of the people who did really well, and I was on it from the beginning. So I started to get a bit of momentum there. And then I just, you know, kept going doing, I think a lot of it is also I do drawings almost every day.
Yeah, I think that helps a lot when you post something almost every day. I've noticed that because I have like waves. Now, I'm just sort of like for last 2 weeks, I'm just like, fuck off from all the social media, basically trying to sort of like relax, do something that is not art related, because there's a lot of work that I have to wrap up and I just want to have my mindset clear. But I've noticed definitely like for anyone who's interested in, you know, having their own following, and the way you grow the following is basically posting every day is probably the best advice you can get. Like, obviously your art going to make or break your Instagram account and make people follow you or not. If you have a bad art and you post every day, people just unfollow because they don't want to see it. But I've noticed like the differences
also,
are
like,
huge.
You get better.
Oh yeah, for sure. And it kind of creates a habit too. Like if you do it every day and you do something for a long, long time, it creates a habit. One of the great examples of that, I don't know if you heard about Beeple. You know who Beeple is? Is this guy? He's an awesome human being, by the way. We had him on the podcast a couple of times. Beeple is this guy who started. I think he was the originator of the everydays movement. Like this sort of like posting every day. On social media. He started 10 years ago, and his work revolves primarily around Cinema 4D and Octane. So he does those like crazy looking cool sort of like abstract renders, not fully abstract. You can still understand what you're seeing. There's other artists that make like fully abstract stuff. You're like, I don't know what I'm looking at, but it's beautiful. Like here you kind of get like, that's Beeple. Like right away. You can actually Google him. It's beeple-crap.com. And he's been doing that for 10 years every day. He's just had his 10-year anniversary. And, it's like, whether he's traveling or not, whether he's doing this or that or not, he's just like, there's always, always art coming from him every day. And you can see it. Like, dude, where do you find time for this?
Like, that's insane.
Sort of like part of my day. So I guess he's up for another 10 years of doing that. Yeah.
Well, I did have, I think about a year ago, I did have a bit of a stress thing where I was, you know, I felt that I have to post something. And at the end, it was just like, I have to draw something. I don't care what it is. I just have to draw something to put it on social media. And that was really, really bad because I didn't develop my skill set in any way. And it just felt, you know, it felt really, it didn't feel good. Like, it wasn't fun. Anything. I don't know how I got over the hurdle, but now I'm just back at the thing where I draw for myself, and at the end of the day, I post it. A lot of the time, you know, I get up and get in the morning, and I do a quick, you know, warm up sketch, and then, you know, at the end of the day, just before I leave the office, I color it in and I post it. So it's just part of the
routine.
The routine, and it's not like a hassle. And it is, you know, pretty quick sketches, the ones that I put out, because
there's
the ones
nice
where
though.
You know.
They look really nice.
Thank you.
Those are very nice. Let me actually put up. It's right here. Put it up so people can see it. Yeah, if you go on your Instagram, I'm actually going to post it to the chat. I'm going to make sure it's posted in the comments too. But yeah, if you go there and you can see those sketches. They are pretty straightforward, simple, but they look awesome. You definitely developed a style that it's very, very Disney-esque, I would say. Like I wouldn't be mad to see a film filmed from Disney done that way, because it feels like it could
well,
be a Disney film.
If you have a number, you feel free to let them know. I think it's. I've heard somebody say, and I actually took that to heart. So now I'm just saying that that's inspiring me. But I've heard that it's a mixture between Disney style and advertising style in Denmark in the 60s. There's like advertising style over here, which
Denmark,
I'm like, okay.
Denmark has, I always sort of like Denmark, I think, had like this really great, I don't know, I'm probably talking out of my ass right now, but I always like when I feel think Denmark in 70s and 80s, it reminds me of that graphic style for some reason. I don't know why. Maybe because I've
it
seen
is,
some of the work.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It is very, very graphic and flat, and there's a lot of amazing designs, both furniture and image
right.
and designers and stuff coming out of Denmark in the 60s and 70s.
Cool.
It's definitely worth looking into.
Yeah, I definitely will. I think I just might have stumbled upon something and read something somewhere. It's just like with anything with life, unless it's a part of your focus when you're just spending every day, you know, focusing on something, everything mm-hmm. else just becomes this sort of, I've heard it maybe somewhere and sort of like, I don't know, that kind of thing, you know?
Oh, my whole life is like that. It's like, oh, I think I know that guy, but I need to, like, for instance,
like
I go
a
to,
bro science meme.
Yeah, I go to CTN every year in LA, which is a creative talent networking expo, which is
okay.
a lot of visual development artists in Burbank, meeting up in Burbank every year. And, you know, I see a lot of people's names and I have no idea who they are, because it's just one of those, you know, you hear the name and it just, you know, keeps going. So it's not until you see their artwork where you're like, oh, okay, I know who you are now. Like
yeah.
it's one of those, you know, it's just
exactly.
part of the...
You run into that issue. How embarrassing it is when you talk with a person that you've talked with before and then you don't remember their name because you've talked to so many
yeah.
people already. That's like the worst thing about the social media, I think. I've noticed like pretty quickly when I had like a small following. I don't have as big following as yours, by the way. I mean, I'm not even 100,000 on Instagram, which by the way, it's a big number for an artist, but
yeah.
it's not like a huge number either. But I've noticed that after a certain amount of people that you interact with, it's like all of a sudden it just becomes this blur and you cannot really pinpoint who's who because there's just too many of them, too many
yeah.
of people. And it's not like you're trying to be disrespectful or anything, and you talk with someone and you don't remember. It's because I think there was like actually scientific explanation to this, that there's a certain number of people in your life that you can have. I can't remember the Dunbar number, I think, or I can't remember if that's the name of it, but there's definitely a number, like a rough estimate number of people that for an average human being, you only remember this many names and this many people by name. And everything else is sort of like out of your memory because it just doesn't, you know, compute anymore in your brain. I think
yeah.
it was Dunbar number. I can't remember. I would have to look it up.
It sounds right. Yeah. Well, it sounds right. Yeah.
Yeah.
It's also because I do have a lot of followers, and I don't know why I got so lucky, but they're all extremely nice. Like
there's
all of
so
them are writing really amazing.
There's so many freaks out
people,
there.
People can be really mean, and a lot of other forums that I've, you know, have my stuff on, a lot of the time, like, they can be a bit more harsh there. But
right.
on Instagram, people just have this tone that is really nice and it's more inclusive. And I do try to engage once in a while, even though it's a bit hard. But it is one of those where people are like, oh, remember me? And I'm like, no. But what's your name on Instagram? Because then maybe like it's
yeah,
it's
hard.
Really hard. But just try to be nice to people and you know, have them remind you if
I try to always remind people that follow my work is that even if I don't reply, it doesn't mean that I ignore you. It just means that there's way too much shit going on. For
oh,
me
yeah,
to
for
take
sure.
care of it.
Yeah.
Although, like, I've been listening to some of the,
what's his name? Gary Vershnychuk. I can't remember his name, his last name. Gary V, basically. Like, if you Google up Gary V, he's like a motivational speaker. He does like motivational books. And his philosophy is to reply absolutely to everybody every time. Oh, and he has like thousands of emails that he spends like half a day replying to. I don't know. Like, maybe, maybe his brain works like that.
Yeah.
But then I listened to Tim Ferriss, and he says like he has assistants that check his emails, and he only like they filter. He has a staff that check his email, like a person that are hired only to check his emails. And they filter it and just send him only important stuff, because he gets like 10,000 emails a day.
Oh, that's insane.
It's just like,
I must admit, I actually also, I have one who helps me with my email once a week, because I do get a lot of stuff as well, because she helps me with my shop. So she's taking on the task of some of my emails as well.
Very cool.
Yeah, because there is a lot, but yeah, I don't, if you also comments and stuff, if you had to answer everything, it would be insane. Luckily, a lot of times it would be full-time work, but I do actually have followers who answer other followers because they ask something that somebody else already asked. So there is like a nice community happening, which is,
that's true. I've noticed that.
I love to see. Yeah.
I've noticed that a couple of times where if people ask questions, like even here on the chat, like, I'm looking at the chat as we're talking and, you know, people are just like chipping in constantly and answering each other questions. So that's awesome.
That's cool. Yeah.
Yeah. I really enjoyed that. I wish I could have like a personal time with almost everybody, but it's just like impossible with work and personal projects or even just the time. Like, I just want to sit and do nothing time.
Mm. Oh, like, yeah.
It's you kind of need that.
I've had, no phone at this time and stuff, you know, no devices.
Yeah.
Stuff, because it's constant, and I'm like you. I would love to. That's why I love CTN. I love visiting people, and I love like having people come over and say, you know, they follow me on Instagram and we have a nice talk, and I love to talk to everybody like that. So yeah.
It's so much really better because you have your time specific for that. Like, this is, I came here to meet with the people, to talk with everybody, to get inspired. And that's the perfect time to basically.
And I'm also very visual. It's really hard to just talk to somebody when it's just a text. Yeah.
Like before we started this conversation, I was saying like it would be so much nicer to have a conversation in person, like in a studio, because like face to face conversation is so much different than like even on the Skype. Like, I interrupt you so many times by accident, mostly because there's a delay. And it's really difficult to like get the conversation going and like remove those awkward moments of silence where, should I talk now? That kind of stuff. So I'm trying to like get better at it, but it becomes like a little bit of disconnect and impersonal, specifically because of that. Like, if you don't have that face-to-face interaction with person, that's why I feel like, you know, places like CTN and other places where you go to for like workshops and to meet with the speakers and whatnot, those are the great places for hangouts and connections, because that's the time that someone who might not have time to answer you on your DMs will be able to answer you in person when you approach them, right? I feel like that's the time to do it, and it's also like so much more personal, and you know, I've noticed that I'm pretty sure Andrew is with us today, and he's quietly looking at chat and and listening to us. But I mean, I run a company with him. We have our school called Learn Squared. We have an online art school. We do online courses, and oftentimes when we have conversations with one another, when we do it over chat, it's almost always ends up with argument. Like, we're always disagreeing, like, what the fuck? Like, what are you talking about? Like, because we're like passionate. And then when we have a conversation, even over a phone call, it's like, oh yeah, we're actually talking about the same thing.
It's so much easier. And everything sounds so harsh when you write it down.
Yeah, because you want to write down something real quick to answer a question.
Yeah.
But because you're not really paying attention and thinking as you're writing, it might sound like a fuck off.
yeah,
kind of like
sure.
Answer.
yeah,
it's true. So last question before we get into actual community questions. So how do you think your Instagram following helps you with things like Kickstarter or your personal development? Apart from the fact that, you know, just the fact that by virtue of being exposed to other artists, you kind of felt like you've developed your own style that way by being inspired and sort of like taking that inspiration and developing into your own thing. But I'm curious, like from more of a social media interaction and how it helps to build your own brand, almost like thinking about the brand specifically. Because like when I look at your account, like, I mean, speaking strictly business terms, it feels like a brand. Like, it, you know, you could easily change it to a name of a company and it'll be like, hell yeah, you know, like I dig that kind of stuff.
Well, actually, I'm really, really bad at having a business plan for what I want to do with my own stuff. So if you have any idea, yes. I think I'm one of the few people who have so many followers on Instagram and still don't know how, like, what to do with it. I'm just, you know, enjoying the ride. But in terms of work, it has done a lot. The work that I did for Warner Brothers, where I worked for 3 years almost with DC Superhero Girls, I got through my Instagram. And a lot of the big companies have contacted me and I've done work for them. I've worked for Mattel, Nickelodeon, Disney Publishing, a lot of those, DreamWorks, have done something for DreamWorks. Mm-hmm. And all of them have contacted me because of my Instagram, and they've come back because of the work that I delivered. So it's been a good way for people to notice the work. I think they've seen that it's consistent. It's, you know, it comes out so often, so it's not like I've sit there and worked on that one drawing for you know, everybody right. can make a good drawing if you sit and work on it for 2 months, but you can see it's like, it's daily. So through my Instagram, I've been contacted by bigger companies and they have given me work. And also because of my Instagram, that's why my Kickstarter is possible. Like, I could not in any way, I wouldn't have dared even to do it. Like, I couldn't have done it without my following on Instagram, Tumblr, Twitter, and Facebook.
Right.
Because those are the people who have you know, who love my stuff, and they've come out and supported the work. So, and it's also, you know, when I did the last Kickstarter, I had a lot of people contact me like, I did a Kickstarter and it didn't work out. And I wanted to know, you know, what backing kit did you use, or who promoted your work, and what, you know, what advertising did you do? And it's just, I did my own advertising. I developed my own community kind of thing where, you know, when I post something, it comes out to a lot of people. And if just a small percent of that people are interested, you know, it can be done. So, but it's also a lot of work, and as you said,
like,
you know,
like anything. Yeah.
Yeah.
I was looking into it personally, and the more I look into like developing your own sort of brand, where you become a person that, you know, you create work, you build a following, and then you make a living out of it. That by itself, it's equal amount of work, if not more, especially in the beginning when you want to live that lifestyle. I've been interested in that personally for a long time, because it becomes a viable area for artists to thrive. You know,
definitely.
You don't have to work for big companies anymore if you don't want to. Like, if you're smart enough and you really put your all efforts towards creating a proper work, you can succeed in, you know, being outside of the industry. There's a bunch of people that do that very well. There's this there's actually an artist that I was thinking about contacting and talking with, because I'm just really intrigued about her. I think she's from Canada, from what I heard. Her name, I can't remember exactly if I'm spelling it correctly, Sakimi Chan or something like that. She does like this fan art. It's not really my style of work. Like, let's put it out there. It looks like I appreciate a little different kind of style of work personally, but she definitely does something that, you know, works for her. Cause she, I think from the most, for the longest time, she had one of the most successful Patreons in terms of art. And also, you know, Gumroads and all of that stuff. So she's doing really well, like probably better than 99.9% artists out there, just by looking at the sheer numbers of people following and supporting her Patreon. So for me, it's like that becomes a curious topic, because what I find more and more is, like, in this industry, the more options you have as an artist, and if you can be genuine enough for people to actually follow you and support you, that becomes a viable way of living, where you can support your family, you can support your way of life, and you can deliver something back to the community. Whereas when you work, again, like in your case, it's a passion to animation, so I get that you want to work in animation, you want to be in the viz dev, that's one thing. But the other thing is, like, if you're an artist, that you want to be an artist, you enjoy art, but you're stuck with this conundrum of different jobs that you have to take. You hate them, but you have to take to you know keep the lights on. So yeah, that's an interesting topic. I've been exploring that personally, because I find it, like, really intriguing. It's an alien.
I think I am in the middle, I think, because I do sell the book that I made before, and I have some artwork that I'm selling as well, and also the Kickstarter is going pretty well. So I do have, you know, some finances coming in just with, you know, with my artwork, my personal artwork, which means that I don't have to run, as you say, you know, to get those jobs that you don't want to do. And I have a good friend called Liana He, who is also from LA, and we did talk once about whether or not we should both do a Kickstarter or Patreon as well. She also thought about it, but we both agreed that right now it wasn't right for us, because it would just be a full-time job doing, like, what we do now. Like, I don't think I'm ready for it, if that makes any sense. I would like to get more out and do more with other people and have it still as my own little thing. And then knowing that it might be something that I could explore later on. But I do, I know I'm definitely lucky, because if I went out to do a Patreon, it wouldn't be as big of a leap as it would be for other people.
Right.
And I don't think it would be for you either, like, if you went out with your artwork either and did, like, a Patreon, because you do have, as you said, a lot of followers, and you do have, like, this podcast, and you have your school, like, you're already building up this little empire of your own, so it seems like you're doing really well.
Well, I mean, the school is definitely helping out. That's becoming more and more a part of my life, and, you know, more of my focus. I still have to do work, don't get me wrong. it's still the same rhythm as it used to be 5-10 years ago, when I was, like, really eager. Now it's just, like, more of a commitment that I have to deal with, and also family, like, just supporting family and having a growing child. All of that stuff, you know, it is. When you have a kid, that's the moment, like, I don't want to work on this, but I have to, because she has to be fed, you know.
Yeah,
that kind of deal. So it's a very interesting world to me, and looking more into it, I'm thinking about getting some more guests. I already had one really cool guy, Ross Tran. I don't know if you've seen his YouTube channel. If you go to Ross Draws.
Yes, I have.
Yeah, he's such a funny guy. He's such a goober. I love that guy.
He's pretty cool, yeah.
Yeah, yeah. I've talked to him when he started, like very close to when he started. He had, like, on YouTube, maybe 5,000 or 6,000 following, maybe 10,000 following. He was just starting to grow. And then after that podcast, I'm not saying that my podcast helped him. I think it was irrelevant to his career.
Yeah.
But, like, soon after, I saw him grow. Like, I saw that, you know, because he kept doing the same thing over and over, and being consistent and very genuine. Like, to start, super genuine. And
well, that he has that thing about, you know, presence in his video as well. Like, he's not just drawing things. He's also like, look, I'm jumping into water now. And
yeah. The funny part, he started was, like, taking, like, a salad or, like, a burger or something, and creating a character out of it. And now he's doing something different, which is kind of even more funny. He's taking photos of himself and then turning himself into those characters, you know?
Oh yeah, yeah, I've seen that. That's cool.
It's so funny seeing him, and then he becomes like a mermaid or something.
Yeah.
It's so funny. Yeah, that guy's a goober. All right, I think we have a couple of questions. Let's go through them. Andrew, you're there with us?
Yeah, I'm here.
Awesome.
Lingering silently in the dark. Yeah, we've been getting a lot of questions from the beginning of the chat. I guess sorry in advance if we don't get to all of them because there's a bunch, but I'll try and consolidate them.
I'm plugging in the computer if that's why you're wondering what I'm doing. Sorry. I can hear you.
All right, so I guess we'll just start off with one from Ethan that goes, how do you integrate storytelling into a character design?
Oh, deep question from the get-go. Well, if you want to tell a story with your character, it's just, figure out, of course, first what it is that you want to tell with your character. And then I think my way of doing it is as an animator, maybe, put it into the pose or think of an action that the character could be doing to tell that story. I definitely think that my drawings are way better, especially when I work. If I know a narrative of what the character is doing, it's easier to get expressions in, and it's easier to get in, communicate what you want that character to communicate, if that makes any sense. So I think it's just thinking out the situation and thinking up really well about the story, if that makes sense.
Mm-hmm.
Characters does get characters do get better if you know what the story is behind it.
Mm-hmm.
That's why I love to do, when I have to do quick drawings, I love to do characters, for instance, from movies. Like I just did one of Madonna from League of Their Own. It was so much more fun to do her because I knew her character, I knew who she was, so I knew how I wanted to pose her.
Mm-hmm.
If that makes sense.
Yeah, I love that movie.
Mm-hmm, I do.
How did you find your own style, and how long did it take you for you to find it?
I'm still looking.
There's a bunch of questions about style and voice and whatnot.
Yeah. When I was a lot younger, like before school, I did a lot of copying of people that I really liked. It was anything from comic books to Disney movies to storybooks that had great artworks, and I just actually just copied that, and it just became a part of my library. And as I grew older, if you just keep drawing and look at, oh, that hot hand is really well drawn, and you maybe just doodle it down, because then you put it into your vocabulary, and then it happens. It doesn't just happen because it's hard work, but you just have to keep going and your own style will develop. I looked for a style when I was younger, but now I just, I just love drawing. And if I see something cool, I'm like, oh, these lips are cool, and play around with that. And it all becomes part of how you draw and how your characters or whatever it is that you draw will look mm-hmm. like.
Do you look at artwork that much anymore, or you try to find inspiration somewhere else these days?
I think it's all over now. Sometimes I do save a lot of artwork that I like, that people drew, that I see online, mm-hmm. but mostly it's actually rough sketches. It's if somebody has captured something where you're like, oh, that line right there, that, or that finger right there is really unique. And then I just put it into this pile, if I need to draw a hand once, I'll remember this finger because this was really well done. But other than that, I have like a lot of mood boards. It's just with fashion or with just one that's just colors. This sunset is pretty, and these colors would look great in a character once. Or so it's everything now. It's you see it everywhere.
Nice.
And I love original art, like not original, traditional artwork, like Caravaggio. I'm a big Caravaggio fan, or Gustav Klimt is as well. Like. Anything you can just that looks awesome.
Cool.
So Adele says you have such an eye for clothes and fashion on all of your original characters. How do you pick inspiration for outfits and styling for original costume designs?
Pinterest. Pinterest is really good. And also, I love fashion. for myself. So I do look at a lot of, you know, fashion magazines and people in the street. I love looking at street fashion. And it also becomes, as I said, with, for instance, the sunset or the cool thing. It's just all, everything's a part of the visual vocabulary. So you make mental notes and you save pictures and you put things together that you like.
Sweet. More on the subject of characters, because animation is so time consuming. A lot of the designs are quite simplified. How do you choose what parts of a character to exaggerate and what parts to simplify?
I think that comes with knowing anatomy and knowing the characters. I've done a lot of study of anatomy and design, so you kind of know what to push and what to pull. You know, examine all the straight versus curve, all those old rules that everybody who's studied art has heard like a million times. It is a part of learning. It's like getting your own style. I don't think there's actual rules. I think it's just trial and error. Yeah. And looking at what other people did, like, okay, that person drew hair like a helmet. That looks pretty cool. I'll remember that. It's just get inspired by how other people do it and how other people have solved issues, like problems or what you should call them, like that. I think that's a great way to learn. And then at some point you get so good that you start, you know, doing it on your own.
Mm-hmm. Very cool.
Do you use vectors in your work or are you all bitmap?
I have no idea how to use vector at all. I've opened the program one. I think it's Illustrator. Opened it once, mm-hmm. Closed it again. It's like,
you work in Photoshop, right? Mostly.
I do. Yes. I work in Photoshop.
Yeah, I work in Photoshop. Have you ever tried Clip Studio Paint or Manga Studio?
No, not at all. I'm one of those people who worked traditionally for a long time. And then I learned Photoshop to the extent that I needed to learn it. So
I know
a lot of
comic book artists are using Manga Studio, and I've seen a lot of illustrators as well using Manga Studio. There's certain, it's basically works like Photoshop, very, very similar. Like you can actually set up all of the hotkeys and everything to make it exactly like Photoshop. There's certain things that I like about it that makes it feel like it's more of a traditional kind of looking work.
Oh, nice. Well, I have heard good things about it. I remember when it came out, a lot of people were talking about it.
Yeah, they've been improving a lot too. I've been actually, for my personal work, when I'm doing kind of like drawing kinds of work for my personal projects, for the Showtime project, I'm only working with that these days.
Oh, okay.
It has this lazy feel where it's sort of like interpolates your lines too. So it's almost like you can get those, especially animation kind of lines where you want to have like this really cool, like eyelashes, right? Where it's just like perfect line. It's not like jaggy because your pen moved or something. Like it's very easy to do it with that. Definitely helps out with that kind of stuff. Yeah, it's pretty cool. Nice. I enjoy it.
Yeah, I've used them. I just got an iPad Pro. So I use the Procreate app sometimes when I'm sitting at home. But I would never use it for work. I use it just for you know, when I want to doodle on my free time. So I use that a bit as well, but I've never worked in vector.
Cool.
So Adele asks, what drew you to most lineless art? Or what drew you most to lineless art? And how did you decide that that would be your final style? I sometimes feel like line art is cheating a little in art, but it depends on the style.
I think I worked a lot with lines for a long time. And I think I just did it without once and it looked pretty cool. I think I was just playing around. A lot of other artists have done it as well. So I saw it somewhere. And I know that a lot of, again, the Danish illustrators from the 60s and 70s did lineless art. But I actually am starting to incorporate a bit of line work now again. But that's just as a final thought, you know, to make the image pop a bit. So it's not really anything that I just, you know, I decided on. I just, you know, it looks cool. Let's do this for a while.
Cool. William asks, he would love to hear about the weekly workload of a pro artist and how fast will you need to be able to produce at the beginning to keep a job once you finally get one, like a character sheet per week or an environment a day or whatever.
Oh, that depends on so much. I have worked on a project where I had a month to develop two characters. Like, they had to be perfect. So we just, you know, back and forth and turnarounds and they, you know, designs and stuff. And then I've had other projects where, again, start Monday, finish product Friday, and you needed five characters. So you really can't say it like that. I think it's something you have to experience for yourself, because it depends. Is it a feature project? Is it a commercial project? Is it a short movie? Is it very early in the pre-production where you have a lot of time? Is it in the crunch session where you just need something to animate or something? But it's a lot
range.
Like, it is really big range. I don't even know if I can come with a certain answer. I can let you know that I work pretty fast, and I'm here around 9 a.m. and I leave around 7 or 8 if I don't have anything I have to be at.
Yeah.
Like on the work days, 7 or 8, maybe 9.
It's not 9.
I'm still here today. No, it's not. Like, I'm still here. It's 11 in the evening in Denmark.
We're keeping you up here.
No, it's fine. It's just, no, let me know that it's long hours sometimes, and sometimes no weekends. And,
yeah, sometimes all-nighters too, depending on what kind of projects you are on. It so varies depending on the project and the state of the project, who you're working with, who's the director, who's the production designer, who's the art director. I worked with production designers that were super cool to work with. Like, you would develop ideas as you go and we would move fast. I worked with directors and production designers where it would just be a struggle always, like finding the right language that they want to proceed with. And that means, you know, especially with freelance, I don't know what's your approach personally, but to me, it's always like, if something's not right, I know I have to put extra hours. I'm not going to get paid for it, but they don't care. They want to see the good art. And if you fail, then they will not contact you ever again.
Yeah,
it might be a lost opportunity for something better. So,
yeah. And also, you think freelance gives you more free time?
Nope.
Mm.
It does give you a flexibility of starting your day when you want it to and ending
it does,
when you want it to, but it definitely does not give you a flexibility of having more time. That's not a case. The worst thing about freelance, the best thing about freelance, is the flexibility. The worst is the fact that you have to be on top of yourself and really avoid distractions at all costs. Because in studio, you can be distracted. And sort of it slips away because there's so many people in the studio that it's hard to keep up. But if you're that freelancer that they're, you know, you're billing for hours, then I want to see those hours done.
definitely do.
Yeah.
Let's get maybe a couple more.
Like one or two more questions and wrap it up.
Okay. How would you approach illustration for merchandising compared to traditional art?
Do you mean traditional art, like, if I were to do art for galleries, or do you mean?
I assume so. Yeah. Just like, I guess personal art, maybe.
Personal art. I don't know. I think my approach is the same when it starts. Like, I produce it for me, like, because a lot of the times people contact me because they like the style that I have, which is very fortunate for me. So I approach it with, you know, my style and how I would do it for myself. And then, but I do it really roughly. Like, I do very quick sketches. That's how I work. And then I send them off for them to be like, yeah, that's what we're looking for, or not at all. That's not what we're looking for. So I think my startup approach is the same. And then I have to fill out the people that I'm working for, like how, what they want. If it's some, like, I have instructor or directors that I work with a lot of times, so I know what they want and I can approach it like that. But if it's somebody who is new and I don't know what they're looking for, you have to start up just being truly yourself, and then you know, feeling it as you go. That's my experience. Mm-hmm. And, you know, be able to be flexible and change it, but, you know, put out something strong from the beginning. That's something you really believe in yourself. Mm-hmm. I think that's how I approach doing commercial work.
Cool.
So it's kind of the same.
Cool. I guess we can wrap it up with one last fun one from Kalina. It's, what is your favorite Pixar or Disney film?
It's easy. It's it's The Little Mermaid.
That's what got you started.
Yeah.
Yeah, it makes sense.
There is a lot of ones that I love. I love the visual art from Sleeping Beauty. I love a lot of the stories from a lot of the Pixar movies, but if it's the one that's, you know, closest to my heart, it's definitely The Little Mermaid.
Nice.
Yeah. Makes sense. I watched that. It wasn't my thing, obviously.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
But I did cry during Lion King, so.
There you go.
cool. Well, mm-hmm. Let's wrap it up here. We had almost 2 hours of conversation out of this.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, time's flying.
It does.
Yeah, thanks so much for having time for us and being here. I really appreciate it. I love your work again. I've been following you on Instagram for a while. I don't follow that many people. I used to follow much more, but I just like,
you have to cut it down.
Yeah, if you follow too many, then you're not seeing the good stuff.
Well, thank you then.
You know what I mean?
I'm very honored.
So good luck with your Kickstarter. And thanks again for being here. Thanks for everyone who joined us on that 4th of July. And
happy 4th of July, you guys.
Thank you.
thank you.
And thanks for every question that was asked here. And sorry for not answering them all. We just ran out of time. So till the next time, guys. Thanks a lot. And I'll see you next time. Bye-bye.
Bye.